If you're looking for live local music from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, you came to the right place. Welcome to Hugh Shows.
We're all at the Hugh Show. It's a lot of fun. He's got all the answers. Yeah, he's got them written down. So let's all watch a Hugh Show till he gets to number one.
Thank you so much for joining us. I'm your host, Hugh Twyman, and I have been writing a music and photography blog in Pittsburgh for over a decade. Check me out at HughShows.com and follow me on Twitter at HughShows and Facebook. On this episode, my special guest is Gab Bonesso, a local performer who will be discussing her musical tastes with a segment I call First Last. But first, my musical guest is Zak Kane, songwriter for Grand Piano, a honky-tonk math rock band who seamlessly navigate through their jazz, blues, and roots influences with a genre-busting sound you have to experience to understand. Performing a song from his former band's out-of-print self-titled release, Songs for Crows by Other Birds, please welcome Zak Kane with Stone Roller. Here with Zak Kane from the band Grand Piano. Zak, thanks for coming, man.
Hugh, it's all my pleasure.
I totally appreciate it. You just played a song called Stone Rolling.
I did, yes.
And that's from a release called your old band, right?
It was kind of whenever I started just writing music myself, and it turned into a one-man band with a lot of side help.
Uh-huh.
Songs for Crows by Other Birds.
And when did that come out?
It never really did. I recorded it at home on an 8-track and gave copies away, and Still on a computer somewhere.
Okay, so it's not online anywhere?
No.
Oh, okay. What year was that? Can you remember?
I don't remember.
Okay, so...
2006.
So 2006, is that when you began your career as a songwriter, per se?
I had been at it for probably 2 or 3 years before that, and it's whenever I started to decide that I wanted to actually record it and just have a memory of it.
And so were you playing out before that, or like, what's the timeline?
I did a lot of busking. Mm-hmm. I played in punk bands, and then I decided to actually learn how to play a guitar, and I busked.
And you busked where?
All over the place. I went down the East Coast, I've been up the West Coast.
Really?
Yeah.
Living the life of a busker?
Yeah.
Like basically couch surfing? Or?
Yeah, Zak Kane busker. Yeah.
Nice. How old were you?
22,
right out of high school?
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah, and so?
Worked for a couple of years then.
Where did you grow up? Where were you born?
I grew up in Bethel Park, Pennsylvania.
Okay, and talking to you today about it, that's south.
Yes,
that Mount Lebanon.
South Hills.
Yeah, South Hills. Yes. You grew up there?
I did.
And then you decided to bust out of Bethel Park by busking across the country.
Pretty much, yeah. At that point, I had been living on my own, and I had moved into the city and actually started enjoying a life, you know?
Yeah.
Having a good time, and I showed thanks through music, I guess.
Have you always played when you were a little kid? Or?
I got into it whenever I was probably 12 or 13, but it wasn't more than just like a loud toy.
Yeah.
I started actually probably learning it whenever I was 15 or 16.
Right, and then I guess that's a major decision to do something like that, like decide, hey, I'm gonna be a musician for a while at least, and then go. Were you scared or were you alone or how did that?
I did go with a good friend of mine, Steven Rush. He's the man. He played mandolin and I played guitar and I had actually never sang before. I didn't sing ever until I was about 21 and learned open chords and I just practiced singing.
Yeah.
A lot of people had to listen to me sing real bad. A lot of people still do need to sing or listen to me sing real bad.
How do you describe your sound? I kind of, like in the intro, I described grand piano as, I think you guys described it as, math rock, honky-tonk math rock with all, can you pinpoint it?
No, I really can't.
Right.
I don't know. I know as far as it goes for me, whenever I write a song, sometimes I'll be like, I want this to be a country song, or this is jazzy and cool sounding, or just rock and roll.
So you don't,
want
to be defined and like cornered into anything, it seems like.
I don't think I really could. I don't.
Yeah.
It's like wind, I don't know. Some days I want to do country music and be
wind.
Chill, and other days I want to kick rocks and play rock and roll.
So how does that translate with your bandmates in grand piano? Are they, it seems like they're definitely game for whatever.
Yeah, they're a pretty loose bunch. They, really what it comes down to is we all like a lot of different music and we share it with each other and we basically just end up trying to do what we hear, because it's what we all love.
So who writes the songs? Would you call yourself the main singer-songwriter of the band, or no?
Yeah, Thomas has been singing more and more lately, which is cool. I do sing a lot too, but we also have a lot of instrumental songs.
Yeah.
So
yeah, you do, huh?
Yeah.
And how does that work out? Somebody just comes in with a riff or an idea, or?
Sometimes someone comes in with a riff, other times we'll just mess up and that turns into something we all like.
That turns into an EP of songs about, and speaking of your releases, you have releases that are themed.
Yes, yes.
So the first themed release would be, like I know $1,000, do you have what's the $1,000?
That was an EP.
Okay, that was your first grand piano.
Yeah,
right?
That was the first grand piano
cool.
recording that we did.
And it was called?
$1,000.
So the theme was not really a theme.
Yeah, we were still pretty scatterbrained.
Cool.
I don't know. We had a lot of great ideas, and we still play a lot of those songs on there.
Yeah.
It was just, I don't know. We were getting our feet wet.
Right, yeah. But so now you're evolving into these themed EPs that, like, one was sea, and it was all about water.
Yeah, creatures of the oceans and creatures of the sea.
And you had one, a bug?
Yeah.
Okay, and that was all about
bugs.
Your latest one that you are going to perform soon, the one that just came out, is Jail.
Yes. It's a two-song EP.
Two-song EP about incarceration.
Yes.
And then later you're going to play a song about, it's coming out, the Mississippi.
Oh, yeah, it's an unreleased song.
Okay,
it's a freebie.
Cool. It's a freebie that our viewers is exclusive.
Viewer exclusive.
See? HughShows TV. Let's bring them the goods, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So well, that'll eventually come out, right?
Yeah, we will do something with it. I have showed the Grand Piano Boys the tune, and we're working out our melodies.
Nice.
It's pretty cool. I'm happy about it. I'm
nice.
Excited about it.
Do you like playing with those guys?
I hate it.
Because they suck?
Yeah. No, it's awesome. I wouldn't want to play with anybody else. They're like my best friends.
Yeah.
And
the crowds love what you do. I mean, do you get that energy from the crowds?
I do. You know? I love playing
live
shows. There's just something to it, being able to get up around a bunch of friends and pick up something that's really loud and just make noise on it and have some beers
and
good laughs and good times. It's just, I love playing shows.
And it's great that it shows the feeling that you don't take yourself so seriously, and that vibe is like contagious with the audience. So, and that's what I get out of it. I love it.
Yeah.
It's gonna be fun. And we're gonna, you played the HughShows Secret Santa Palooza the first year.
Yes.
And then the second year you were didn't play, but then we're scheduled to play this third year.
Yeah.
We're gonna party up. Yeah, let's party up, man.
Yeah, it's gonna be a fun filled evening.
Absolutely, and I so appreciate you doing that, and I really appreciate you coming, man.
Oh, thanks for having me. It's really all my pleasure. This has been awesome.
It's mutual, man. Thanks, buddy. Right on. Now you're gonna play a song, another grand piano song, and we're gonna go right into that, and it's gonna blow your mind.
Yeah.
Yeah!
Performing a recent grand piano single, once again, here's Zak Kane with Spend the Night in Jail.
Take that pen and throw it in and hope it all gets found. Let's live life, have it mess us around. Sometimes we'll feel fine. Well, the times will be in a bind. always got a look 'em in their eyes. Think I'll spend the night in jail. Think I'll spend the night in jail. Dream about my goodwill. I'll try and make it seem real. I think I'll spend the night in jail. Yeah.
That's a good one?
Yeah.
Yeah! My special guest tonight is Gab Bonesso, who is a performer, and we were deciding comedian or like, what you tell me.
Well, I see myself as a comedian, an actress, and a children's entertainer, so I like to think I'm just an overall performer, you know?
Right, and the Josh and Gab performances, when did you start that?
We started that, we created it in 2012, so it's okay. Basically a live, I like to call it modern vaudeville, where Josh Rabanitz of Meeting Important People and I go into schools and we do a mix of stand-up comedy, motivational speaking, rock and roll, and hip-hop music.
Yeah.
And we just basically tell our stories of being bullied as kids and then try to inspire the kids through seeing us live and seeing that we did overcome our challenges.
And the songs are all original.
Oh, they're all original.
Yeah, you guys write them together?
Oh, definitely, yeah. He, I mean, the first album, Josh wrote five of the six songs. I wrote one that I thought was a joke. I was like, Josh, I wrote this song for my stand-up. And he's like, we're putting it on the album. It's called Rats. It's so silly and absurd. But that got the songwriting bug in me. And so our next album, I wrote two or three songs on it.
Nice.
And I mean, Josh and I work together. I mean, I come up with like, it just like comes in my head. And I'm like, Josh, what do we do? And he writes the guitar part. And
right. And really so fun. This is album number two?
We just did album number two last summer. We put out, it was our mixtape. So
okay.
It was sort of like 12 songs,
nice.
A mix of different stuff. Stuff that wasn't all anti-bully. Like we had some, like I wrote an original song called Insanity that's just like celebrating being yourself and being crazy. And then we did a couple ads for television, so we put those songs on as well.
Nice.
So it's a nice
mix. So we can find you at joshandgab.com?
Yep, joshandgab.com, or you can just find me at gabbonesso.com.
And what and your solo stuff, like where can I see you out?
Oh man, the solo stuff. So I do all different kinds of stuff. I can do crazy adult that kids should never see, and
right.
I can do family friendly that everyone can come to. So over the summer, I'm going to actually be performing at a ton of different venues.
Right.
I'm going to be doing a mix of one, you know, one show here adult, one show here family friendly.
So is it blue? Your adult oriented stuff?
I get
stuff?
Crazy.
Yeah.
I mean, when I first started, I wanted to be the next Lenny Bruce.
Wow.
But then I realized I wasn't having fun anymore. So then I read an autobiography by Steve Martin called Born Standing, and it really kind of inspired me to just laugh at myself.
Yeah.
So I took on more of an absurd voice in my stand-up, and now it's just really a mix of just autobiographical insane. My life is insane.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't even just go take a walk in my neighborhood without like being chased by a deer or having like a rabid dog gnaw at my leg.
Yeah.
And so it all finds its way into my act.
Well, I saw the Josh and Gab, I think it was the Josh and Gab, and the funniest thing I've ever seen is you scatting.
Oh my God.
That's great.
Thank you.
That is hilarious.
Thank you. If you come see me do stand-up, I sometimes do Billie Holiday impersonation, so it gets really weird
quickly.
But I'll be at like the Parkway Theater in the Keys Rocks area. I'm going to be at Arcade Comedy Theater. I'm going to be at the Oaks Theater.
Cool.
You'll find me at places all over
nice.
The summer, so I'm really excited. Yeah.
Well, this is a segment I call First Last, and First Last is to get your musical experiences and your influences throughout your life, so pretty easy. You ready?
I'm excited.
Cool. The first album you ever bought?
Okay, well, I was a kid and I didn't actually pay for it, but I got a Jimmy Durante Best Of album because I was obsessed with the ink and ankity. So I forced my parents to search everywhere in this Pittsburgh region to find me a Jimmy Durante CD, and we bought it. It was the first one I actually like bought myself.
Do you still have it?
I do still have it.
Do you
really? I have all my CDs. Yeah, I'm not that person who sold them yet. So
cool.
I'm a hoarder.
Yeah. The last album you bought.
Okay, I don't know. I knew this might be controversial, Hugh.
It's going to be.
Hashtag Lemonade. I bought the Beyonce album, and I have not stopped listening
really?
To it. Oh, my God. Okay. It speaks to my soul and my being a woman.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's awesome.
Nice.
But I love, like, you know, hip-hop and R&B.
Yeah,
and that
yeah.
Stuff too, so.
That's cool. And that came out a few weeks ago.
Just 2 weeks ago. Yeah.
Yeah. And these surprise drop albums.
I know.
You know what I mean?
It came out of nowhere.
Yeah, right.
I mean, she's, I don't know why
on
she
Sunday
does that.
Nights.
Yeah, on of Sunday, on time. HBO.
Yeah,
yeah
right,
it
right.
was really random and really awesome.
Cool,
yeah.
cool. Your favorite album of all time?
Ooh, so, yeah. My favorite album of all time, I'm just going to go ahead and say it, and, you know, it's a musical theater album. I'm obsessed with the original London recording of Jesus Christ Superstar, both discs.
Yes.
I can listen to it all year long. Grew up on that album. My family was really obsessed with
it. Yeah, mine was too, and we would just sing it to each other and just, like, play the parts, and we'd all interchange the parts. And
us too!
Yeah, I know. It's a great album.
Yes!
And it's funny, I don't really like Broadway or cast albums at all.
Right.
But that's one of my favorite albums of all time. It's so good.
Oh, it's so good.
I know. And I get mad when I hear different versions.
Me too.
You know what I mean?
It has to be the original.
You know, the movie, Ted Neely.
No. I mean, Carl Anderson, he's great, but no, I don't like it.
Right,
I mean, that added song with the mandolin,
Or even if you see it on YouTube, like, it just doesn't work.
No.
These other cast productions. You
I
know?
Agree.
Yeah,
it has to
cool.
be the original, yeah.
That's awesome.
Cool, thanks. I thought you were going to be like, oh, music.
No, I'm right with
see,
you.
See, you're a real music guy, so that's why I was like, I'm nervous.
That's awesome.
Cool.
Your least favorite or most disappointing album?
Oh, my least favorite and most disappointing album. Well, you know, I made bad choices in the 90s, you know.
I think we all did, but
I got into Backstreet Boys, I got into NSYNC, but I would say of the boy bands, I bought the O-Town album, and I really regret that today. Like, I'll look at it and be like, what were you doing? Why did this happen?
And you still have it because you have
that. And I still have it because I'm a hoarder.
Right.
But I did, and one of the boys was really cute in the band. But no, I actually saw
Well, that's
live.
The only saving grace, I guess.
That was the only saving grace.
But
yeah,
you saw them?
I did see them live, and I was sad about it. I'm sad about it all. Yeah, the 90s were a dark time, you know?
Yeah, they were. That's the last.
At the end.
I cut my subscription to Rolling Stone when the Backstreet Boys were on. I'm like, what am I doing?
Yeah.
Done.
It was.
Yeah.
That's kind of when music died.
Right. Your favorite concert, or your first concert that you ever went to?
Oh, gosh. God, am I a dork. Okay, so my first album is Jimmy Durante. My first live concert, also in the 90s, was Harry Connick Jr. Yeah, I like thought I was gonna be like this jazz trumpet player when I grew up because that's what I started. My music backing is in trumpet.
Do you play trumpet?
I do play trumpet
okay,
still
cool.
to this day. And Josh and I are trying to work it into the Josh and Gab shows with the band kids. They're like, yeah. But so I don't know why I deluded myself thinking someday I'm gonna be a trumpet player in Harry Connick's band.
Yeah.
So I was obsessed with him. He was just everything to me. I love all that, like, I love standards. Frank Sinatra had been my favorite, like, growing up. And when he came out, I was just like, he's everything.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was my first concert.
Did you enjoy it?
You know what?
You can't really say you'd be embarrassed if you liked it. You
well,
know?
I didn't really enjoy it, to be honest.
Yeah.
But it wasn't Harry's fault. So this particular tour was when he came out with his funk sound. Do you remember when he, like, changed from swing to funk?
No, I don't.
So I was very, like, I was like, what is this? And, like, I remember at the concert, it was me and all elderly people. And, like, he started with, like, two funk songs, and everyone got up and left. So I got better seats as a result. But I also had cracked a tooth at the concert. So I was just, like, in miserable pain, listening to funk. I'm like, please just play a standard.
This question's coming later, but
okay.
The last concert you went to?
The last concert I went to, ooh, was Nico Case at Mr. Smalls.
Nice.
My brother took me for my birthday.
How many times have you seen her?
That was the first time I saw her, but I never thought a person could sing that
live.
Perfectly. Yeah.
Live, right.
I mean, that's
right.
What blew my mind. Like, her album's one thing, but I was like, I don't know if she'll live up. I'm done. I will see her live every time she comes through.
I saw her four times, and the first time it was at the Byam, and it, you know, everybody's sitting on their hands at the Byam, you know, like, real respectful, and she's just like, whoa.
I know, I get chills, actually. I just, like, literally had a sense memory thinking of her voice, like, live.
You know who did that for me? I was so surprised how great they sang live is Ryan Adams.
Oh, yeah, I've seen him live.
I was in the show, and he was just singing the song, and I'm like, wow. This guy, this is why he's doing it.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have such appreciation for people who, like, because now that, like, Josh and I, we'll do, like, three shows a day every day of the week sometimes.
Right.
And it's like.
And he tells me, he gets a little.
Yeah, and it's like, how do people do this? Like, I mean, so when I see someone like Nico Case, you know, has been on tour, and you're just like,
wow.
How are you that good?
Yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah.
Cool. Your favorite concert of all time?
Ooh, I do think my favorite concert of all time, although I've had so many fun experiences, mm-hmm. but I really love seeing the Decemberists at the Byam. This was maybe back
2009
yeah.
or 10?
I think it was the one with the Queen's Rebuke and the Rake song
yeah.
and that really
dark album.
It was
the first time they
album.
Played the Byam.
Yes,
right.
And it was, oh my God, that was a phenomenal.
You know they played the Quiet Storm?
Are you kidding
no,
me?
No, their first tour, they came to Pittsburgh, they played the Quiet Storm, which was the coffee shop up.
Yeah,
yeah, that was their first venue here.
That is insane to me.
Yeah, it's pretty nuts. And then that night, I went to this party at Mariage Blanc's house, and they had all these bands playing. But I wanted to go meet the Decemberists at their tour bus that night.
Really?
So I ran down and missed a couple of the bands, and I met the Decemberists outside
of
the stage door.
Were they nice, normal people?
They were super, super nice. Super nice, except Colum and Loy. There were only like three of us waiting to meet him, and he came shooting out of the door right to the bus, and I got him get an autograph, and the other two girls were like, wait, why isn't he coming out?
Aww.
So, they're artists. It's like you can't expect anything.
Right, no.
I just felt bad for these girls.
Yeah, you know? No, totally. I mean, I'm a total neurotic, and people make me terrified all the time, but I could never say no to somebody
yeah.
who would want my autograph. I'd be like, are
right,
you kidding? Yes.
Right. Cool. So the least favorite show... It had to be. If you have another show.
I know. I mean, because I had one of the, I don't know if you remember, like, Jawbreakers. Well, Bazooka made a Jawbreaker lollipop. And the night before Harry Connick Jr., I was trying to make my sister laugh. And I was like, I'm going to make it in one bite.
Crack.
And I was like, ow,
yeah,
I'm sure it's nothing.
Yeah.
And then it started, like, aww. Obsessing at Harry Connick Jr. So that really was. That or, oh God, Hugh, you're taking me down a path, but I'm going to do it.
Okay, come on.
So while I was making really bad musical choices in the 90s, I was obsessed with the Bare Naked Ladies. And so I saw them constantly. And I went as far as to see the keyboard player, Kevin, had his own band. And my sister
wow.
and I went to go see it at a club cafe. And then we were invited by Kevin and the drummer onto the band bus, where insanity ensued, because I think I didn't know what it meant for a girl to be invited onto a band bus.
Yeah,
I was still like
yeah.
way too young. And then when I found out what you're supposed to do, I was like, get me out of
yeah,
here! And
right.
like literally the drummer like took all his clothes off and he was just like,
ooh,
where are you going?
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
And I'm like, I'm out, man, ooh. I'm out. So that was a bad experience too. My sister and I never saw the Bare Naked Ladies
no.
again after that experience.
Oh,
so.
That sucks.
Yeah, so.
That's horrible.
I know. I don't know who that guy was though, but he was the Kevin and Bare Naked Ladies is his drummer, so not the drummer for Bare Naked Ladies.
Yeah,
let's just be clear on that.
Yeah, forget that guy.
Yeah, but that was weird. I didn't know. I really did.
Yeah.
I was a kid.
Well, at least you got out of there.
I got out. My
cool.
sister, like, yeah, saved me.
Right on. Your favorite thoughts or experiences about Pittsburgh? Were you born here?
I am. I'm born in the suburbs, so I'm out by the airport.
Still,
I'm a suburban
come on.
Kid.
Let's
I know.
It, you know.
But Pittsburgh, one of the things I do love about Pittsburgh is that as an artist, we're not under the pressure of a New York or LA.
Mm-hmm.
So we as artists get to experiment much more than I would say any of my friends that started out that were in New York or in LA.
Hmm.
They've never had the opportunity to change their voice. You know, they had to stick with it because they were trying to get signed and trying
yeah.
to get that perfect 5 minutes. And I mean, early on, I was able to book Club Cafe and do an hour set after my first year, whereas I had friends in New York who had been doing stand-up 5 years, and they were like, I've never got to do more than 10 minutes.
Wow.
So, I mean, you really get to practice more here, I think. You really get to be a real artist. You know, you don't have to worry about the commercialism
right.
of it all.
Right.
And I also love that, especially within, I mean, I've been doing this now, even before Josh and Gab, I was making a full-time living doing different things, whether it's
right.
been acting, writing.
How long before? Like, how long have you been doing it?
Oh, my gosh. I've been doing stand-up since 2004.
Wow.
So,
yeah, 12 years.
Yeah, yeah,
wow,
really long
nice.
Time.
Yeah.
So, right out of college, yeah, I went to Duquesne and majored in theater, and then boom, and then all my professors were like, you're not an ingenue. What are you going to do? You need
yeah.
to write. You need to become a writer.
Right.
And so I was like, well, stand-up sort of a way I can act and write, and maybe that'll work.
Like, are you talking to open mics nights, too? Like, there's an abundance of opportunity.
Yeah, yeah. Now, back then, there wasn't. So
okay.
back then, there was just the Funny Bone and the Improv, and
wow.
they basically said you can't work at both clubs. You had
mm-hmm.
to decide if you're an improv
mm-hmm.
person. And so I, at the time, went to Club Cafe, and I was
yeah.
just like, look, can I do a weekly show? And they let me, and they paid me.
Nice.
It was crazy.
Yeah.
It was at a time
yeah.
where it was, right before the recession, so
yeah.
people were throwing artists.
Yeah.
yeah. And so, yeah, I've just been really lucky to get tons of different... I mean, I do the Brillo. I've been doing the Brillo Box for 10 years. I have a regular Tuesday once a month for
wow.
10 years, and that's where people know they can go see me for free and I will always be working out new material. That's like my home base to like, but it's just great. And like Josh and I mean, I think if Josh and I had to start an anti-bully program out of New York or LA, I mean, we never would have had the quick success that we had here in Pittsburgh.
Right.
So many schools, so many people who knew us in the community,
right.
So many teachers who supported us and were able to get us in front of different schools. It was, yeah, it's a really great city. And, and the fact that you can make a living being an artist is pretty darn cool, I'd
Absolutely.
Say.
Well, thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks for having
me,
Hugh.
I really appreciate it.
I really appreciate it, too.
Cool, thanks.
Thanks.
Yeah!
Finally, Zak takes us out with the latest single release from Grand Piano. Here he is performing Mississippi, Don't Bother Me.
Mississippi, don't bother me, got nowhere to hide. My river's dried and my heart is fried, at least I have a flow. When I die, I'll be by, if you'd be so kind. Till that day, it'll be me, choosing my own way, choosing my own way. Satanic thoughts and hopes I got, don't you get confused. I know my way like in the woods that we used to play. Hear my mom calling out the door, son, it's getting late. Rest your eyes and dream a dream, sip it being yours, sip it being yours. Thoughts and hopes I got, but don't you get confused. I know my way like in the woods that I used to play.
Good. Yeah.
Thank you all so much for tuning in. I want to thank Zak Kane, Gab Bonesso, Dan Yost from Jest Records on Sound. And special thanks to Carl, John B., Doug, and Eric, and everyone here at PCTV. Until next time, always remember to support Pittsburgh music.
We have a way of explaining things to Hugh. Yeah, we have a way of explaining things to Hugh. We have a way of explaining things to Hugh. Yeah, we have a way of explaining things to Hugh. Yeah, we have a way of explaining things to Hugh. Yeah, we have a way of explaining things to Hugh. Yeah, we have a way of explaining things to Hugh. Yeah, we have a way of explaining things to Hugh. Yeah, we have a way of explaining things to Hugh. Yeah, we have a way of explaining things to Hugh. Yeah, we have a way of explaining things to Hugh. Yeah, we have a way of explaining things to Hugh.
it's easy to see. I'll never be free of my worst fear.